On this week's Revolutionary It'll Never Work, we get out of some tight corners.
Catch up with tornadoes and find out why it's a lot less bother when you hover.
All of that to come, but first of all, have you ever had an idea which seemed just too good to be true? A fantastic notion which later on turned out to be not such a good idea after all.
Take Mr. George Musgrove. In 1937, he hit upon the idea of painting yellow lines along the sides of roads. Great way to solve traffic congestion problems, but poor Mr. Musgrove never made a penny from his inspirational notion. In fact, 60 years later, it cost him £20 when he was booked for parking on one of his own yellow lines.
Well, it seemed like a good idea at the time, like French inventor Monsieur Sauvon's indestructible plane. He was convinced you could survive any crash in his aeroplane and was determined to prove it. Unfortunately, the French police thought he was a nutter and confiscated his wheels. But undeterred, Monsieur Sauvon got some mates to push him and his plane off a very high cliff.
After he'd been pulled from the wreckage and regained consciousness, he claimed his invention was a great success. But how about this? A brand new concept, the self-cooling can from Joseph Mitchell. You just pull the tab and it releases hydrofluorocarbon gas, which expands as it escapes, chilling your drink. But the true beauty of this invention is hidden, because hydrofluorocarbon is a potent greenhouse gas. So every can you drink contributes to global warming. So you need to drink more cool drinks, so more global warming. Great, isn't it?
Meteorology. It's the science of weather. And it's not just a case of studying graphs back at base. If you want to know more about what Mother Nature can throw at you, you've got to get right into the thick of it. And that's exactly what this guy does. OK, Tim, let's go storm chasing. OK, so here's the deal. We're heading southeast towards a town called Lamar, and that's in an area that's been nicknamed Tornado Alley. Now, it may look like a beautiful sunny day out there just now, but according to these incoming reports, there's a storm brewing. So, Tim, what exactly are we in for today?
Well, the surface analysis map indicates that we have got a good likelihood of seeing a very special storm called a supercell. A supercell is a very dangerous, very potent storm that is capable of creating large hail and also tornadoes.
Take a storm, add humidity, high winds, whip them up into a frenzy, and what do you get? A tornado. You'll know when you see one, the vortex is unmistakable. Wind speeds of 300 miles per hour have a massive capacity for destruction, knocking down buildings, tossing cars in the air, and blowing over trucks. But perhaps the most frightening thing about a tornado is its unpredictability.
There's a good possibility we actually might have a landspout to form out here, which is a type of a tornado that's very common in Colorado.
Is that the most impressive kind of tornado?
It's not the most impressive, but it can be just as deadly, because the winds in a what we call a landspout can approach 150 plus miles per hour, and that's strong enough to overturn cars, mobile homes, even rip the roofs off of houses. At this point, we're going to try to get to the east of this particular storm here. This storm to our north appears to be weakening, and the storm to the south is gaining strength.
The chances of finding what we were after were looking good. A tornado is formed when warm, moist air being sucked up into a thundercloud interacts with cold air being pushed down out of it. This results in a rapidly spinning column of air, the vortex. They do take a lot of tracking down, which is why Tim's vehicle is packed with gear. Communications equipment, satellite receivers, and GPS mapping systems are all vital. So Tim's always aware of local weather conditions and where he needs to travel.
This storm to the south is dissipating. This storm to the north, but a little further east, is becoming the dominant storm.
Okay, so these two storms might collide and we could see some interesting friction?
Exactly.
I've got to stand and fight in this creation.
But storm chasing is not just about the excitement. Tim is the only chaser to have deployed the snail in the path of an incoming tornado. Developed by Engineering Analysis, it's a seismic device that'll measure the vibrations of a twister. When fully functional, the snail will give advance warning of the size and direction of approaching tornadoes, and ultimately, it could save lives.
I've got to stand and fight in this creation.
But our tornado looked like it wasn't going to touch down. After crossing two states and driving for 18 hours, for us, the chase was over. But for Tim and storm chasers alike, the work goes on. And it's not just about the science. It's an obsession with Mother Nature at her most terrifying.
Now, from Mother Nature at her most awesome to technology at its most inspiring. This week, we've taken pity on Adrian and allowed him out of our dusty patent office to make his own story. Actually, nobody else could be bothered to get up early enough.
When you're late for work, the last thing you need is a navigational nightmare that turns into a driveway disaster. There are some things in life you just can't back out of, and this driveway is one of them.
But now there's a technological turnaround for all those drivers who spent years stuck in reverse. It's a revolution in home revolving, and it's putting the world of automotoring into a bit of a spin.
If you can't move your driveway can now move to you. Buried 2 feet under this metal turntable is a powerhouse of pulleys powered by an electric motor. To turn it on and off, there's no need to get out of your car. It's operated by remote control.
So, with a flick of a switch, the horizon's clear, and there's no more looking back.
You get the revolutionary technology here on It'll Never Work. You also get the ideas that could start a revolution. Yes, I'm talking about your ideas. We've had thousands of entries for the It'll Never Work Useless Inventions competition, and they're all appalling. I can't believe how so many of you can have such bad ideas. It's brilliant.
The It'll Never Work Design Awards. Runner-up, Will Elliott for the Reigning Mac.
Demand for water is at record levels.
Water companies are being urged to
ban using hose pipes and sprinklers.
And authorities are still on the lookout for a wacky water sprinkler known only as the Phantom.
I'm no Phantom. I'm the gardening angel, leaving no leaf unwatered in my quest to test the ingenious Reigning Mac. In my opinion, this device is the gateway to a greener and happier garden. The idea is to attach myself to the nearest available outdoor tap, turn it on and pump it up. Now what's happening here is the water is rushing up through the tubes underneath my jacket and spurting out of these rather impressive valves, making sure that no plant, no tree, not even a pansy will ever go thirsty again.
Cheers.
All right.
Hey, what's your game?
It's the Reigning Mac, the cutting edge of gardening technology. You don't like it, clear off. It's the Reigning Mac. Yeah. I'm getting closer to nature. What do you think?
I think it's rubbish. It looks stupid.
You water your plants and you have some fun at the same time.
It doesn't look like much fun to me, thanks.
Yeah, nice idea, but
it's dribbling as well.
Doesn't really work.
The Reigning Mac is the answer for high-tech horticulturists. And it's surely the route to success for all aspiring gardeners of the year.
the Rainy Mac.
This advertisement has been classified as you for useless. Walking barefoot on grass can be a wonderful experience, as long as there's nothing too sharp lurking under the lush leaves. And that little surprise left by Fido can lead to unexpected underfoot unpleasantness. But now you can negate nature's nastier niggles with a pair of Shindogu lawn sandals. The realistic artificial grass swaddles your soles with a leafy luxuriance and transforms the most testing terrain into top-grade turf. Yes, you'll really put your foot in it if you're not wearing a pair of lawn sandals from Shindogu, the Useless Invention Society. Not available in shops.
You get to do so many weird things on It'll Never Work that you learn to take it in your stride. But when they said they were sending me to California to try out a new kind of wig, well, even I thought that they'd lost it. I mean, A, I don't need a wig. And B, even if I did, I wouldn't need to go to California to try one out. Not that kind of wig, they said. A winging ground effect aircraft. Oh, right. Traffic, so much for life in the fast lane. These days in the rush hour, you're lucky to get out of first gear. But sometimes the best ideas do come from the most static of situations. Inventor Bill Russell got his inspiration to develop a new mode of transport as he sat gridlocked on his way to work. His vision was to utilise the untapped potential of water to create a road network from rivers and the open sea. And now the world's first commercially available ground effect craft is making waves in America. Yes, commuter chaos could well be a thing of the past, and this is why the Flarecraft. But hang on, we saw Radarcraft in Australia last year. That used ground effect and it was a bit of a damn squib.
Would you like to drive?
I'd love to.
Let's go.
Unfortunately, my flight was not to be. Technical problems meant even at top speed, we'd have been overtaken by a pedalo.
Gary, this is going to work, isn't it?
Oh, by all means. It's going to be a nice ride and you're going to enjoy it.
Is Flarecraft a boat or is it a plane?
Well, it's just a combination of between a boat and an airplane. It operates on the principle of a wing-in ground effect, which means that the air that comes into the front of the wing can't escape quite as fast, so you build up a high pressure of air underneath the wing and it rides on that cushion of air.
Could it be used to fly over the ground as well?
It's not really designed to fly over the ground. I mean, it will function over the ground, but say if you were flying over a small spit of a sandbar or something to that effect.
But we couldn't fly it down a street like some futuristic flying car or anything like that.
Maybe in Hollywood, but this craft is designed specifically to stay over water.
Takeoff is bumpy to say the least, but once you get to 60 miles an hour, we're airborne, and the ride is as smooth as silk as you speed your way up to 110 miles an hour on a cushion of air.
It's absolutely brilliant, but it's very noisy!
But landing? Well, I've had better on a roller coaster.
Of just bumping along on the water and then all of a sudden you're clear of it and you're going along at 110 miles an hour with the water rushing underneath you. Absolutely incredible. Well, if Flarecraft is the future of commuting, then this is the life for me.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it, Angela. Would you like to go out and try it again?
Yeah, what do you think? Supper in San Diego?
Sounds great. You're on. We're out of here.
What What better way to get around town than on the subway? But all too often, a mislaid ticket can cause your travel plans to go down the tube. Well, now you can avoid day-return docket disappearance with a pair of Shindogu earring ticket holders, the stylish accessories that let you say ta-ta to ticket location trauma. So don't be sidetracked into an unscheduled sidewalk shopping bag search. Buy a pair of earring ticket holders from Shindogu, the useless invention society. Not available in shops. Ah, Shindogu, as useless as ever. But strange as we are, the human species, and I guess that includes Sally, is the most sophisticated on the planet. We're at the top of the food chain, and our unsuspecting prey doesn't stand a chance. But becoming the sophisticated, intelligent, developed bagel eater you see before you has been a long process. Life on Earth started out as simple cells like amoeba, and whatever you might be thinking, getting from that to this has been a big leap. It's all down to evolution. Millions of changes over billions of years. A process of trial and error. It's given fish gills so they can breathe underwater. Tortoises, hard shells to protect them from falling bagels. And us, well, we've got fingers, useful for all kinds of things. Now, evolution is a natural process, but it's one that scientists now hope to put to work in the supercomputers of the future. Supercomputers and scientists. Sounds impressive. So what have they come up with? Little fluffy gnawns. Now, these gnawns are like the amoeba of artificial life. Pretty basic, not very bright. But even though this is just a game, it is an example of one of the first ever evolutionary computer programs. The gnawns can learn from their virtual environment and have baby gnawns, which can inherit some of their intelligence and cuddly good looks. The key word is evolution. Usually, computers just have to follow the instructions of their human programmers. The new revolution is that now computers are starting to program themselves, learning from their own mistakes and getting smarter and smarter. These new programs are called evolutionary algorithms. Artist William Latham sowed the seed, but it was his computer that used evolutionary algorithms to grow these constantly evolving images. For the first time, computers are grappling with problems in the same way as the human brain. But unlike us, they really can free their mind. Problem: design a machine to boil water. Ask a human, and they'll probably come up with something like this. Set a computer the same task, and it could design anything. The computer will then eliminate the useless designs and evolve the ones with the most potential, all the time coming up with ideas that humans could never think of, until, in the end, computer evolution will give you the perfect kettle. But even if you don't want a new kettle, you might fancy a pet robot. These guys have been programmed so that they can learn from their environment and hopefully stop bumping into each other. Now, even though their brains are small, they're more like human brains than ever before. Nobody really knows how far or fast computer evolution will go, but some top scientists are willing to give it a good guess.
In 50 years' time, we might have a machine which, in its own way, thinks and feels and might even have its own emotions.
It's a strange thought, and not one that everyone agrees with. But one thing is for sure, evolutionary algorithms are going to change the way we think about computers, and the way computers think about us.
Well, who knows what the future holds? But we do know about the past, at least Adrian does. He's been working hard, as always, digging deep through the patent files. And you know, this week, I'm sure he's come up with a world beater. It's a terrific device, patented just a few short years ago. So why did it never take off?
...1991 made it happen for a sheep-shearing robot. There was lots of hot air about the mini-disc, and even more in the world's biggest ever balloon. But what was Frederick Sevilla's sunshade all about? Filled with helium, the idea behind this shiny device is to protect you from the sun's harmful rays. A bit of a parasol for the 90s that leaves your hands free and easy. Well, is it a patent high flyer or a load of hot air? We found out in the little ever work field test.
Rind.
Cake.
That's a big one. Hello again. Catch.
Shoot.
Go. Ow.
Shoot.
Where the snow?
Get out of it.
Ouch. Oh, the lady loves an ice cream. Whoa.
But for an udder opinion, not mooch you can do with that.
So, 1991, a great year for fashion, but what about the sunshade? It's a nice conversation piece, but it doesn't keep you cool. Between you and me, you don't look too cool neither.
Well, that's it for this week, but just before we go, there's still time to take a look at how technology can help you to stay looking good. In Japan at the moment, short skirts with long socks are all the rage. Everyone's wearing them. Only problem is, how do you stop your socks from falling down? A garter, perhaps? Rather uncool. So the Japanese have come up with this. It's a sock glue. You just dab it on your leg like so, lift up the sock. Beautiful. What a great idea. Not a good idea, though, if you've got hairy legs.
Ooh. And if you're a bit of an anorak, this could be the anorak for you. Being developed by a French company, the idea is that solar panels create enough electricity to power your Walkman and your mobile phone. No more costly batteries to buy, no more being cut off mid-phone call. Anyway, what was I saying? Hello? Hello? Although, if you get caught in a sudden downpour, it could end up being a bit of a shocker.
But a few drops of rain won't put a dampener on the occasion if you're wearing this suit. Designed by Nick Ashley, it's made from a special high-tech fibre, which even when soaking wet, will dry within seconds, leaving your suit beautifully clean and perfectly pressed.
But on It'll Never Work, we don't like to just take anyone's word for it.
Oh, no, we test things out to the max.
Does it work?
What's the verdict?
Just one problem. I'm not wearing waterproof underwear.